Welcome back. We missed you. If you were here yesterday, actually, let me just check real quick. Who was here yesterday?
I was day before yesterday.
Day before.
Wednesday.
Sorry. What were you doing here yesterday? No one here.
I missed you.
What were you doing? Who was here 2 days ago?
Partially.
Who was not here 2 days ago? Okay, we got a few. So we're a little ahead of schedule. We found an extra slot, and we used it to cover some of this material. So I figured I would do the advanced version of this talk, because I think you guys can handle it. For the people who weren't here before, if you're unfamiliar with callbacks, quite generally, this might be a little tricky. I want you to feel really comfortable asking questions. They're probably going to be representative of questions that the people who were here 2 days ago are probably still having. So feel free to shout something out and slow me down. Again, for those folks who weren't here, I should probably put in that the format of this lecture is very different from any other lecture you've probably been to. It's almost like a conversation with a lot of people on the other side. I'm going to be working with each of you to try to like figure out how well I've explained something. It's very important to me to know whether I've succeeded or not, and if I don't, I put that on me to fix it and make it clearer. So if I do call on you, it is not to torture you. It is specifically because I see what you wonder about as very relevant to the whole room, and I hope that you will as well. Okay, so what we're going to do here is explore event systems, which are a technique used in programming effectively to invert dependency between two files. You can think of it as the inverse of a method call, and I'll explain what I mean by that in a minute. The way that we're going to explore this use of event systems and the significance of event systems is by building one ourselves. So over the course of these slides, we're going to take a look at some source code that we think has a problem with it. We're going to consider how can we refactor this so that the problem goes away. And what we're going to discover is that we've invented an event system. Let me take a quick poll. You there. What do you think when you hear event system? What does that mean to you? What's your working definition of an event system? So a system where events will happen by some definition, and at the moment those events happen, control flow will go to some part of your code that you've specified. That's pretty much exactly what we're looking at here, right? An event system is a control flow mechanism, much like an if statement or a while statement or even the simple notion of a callback is sort of a control flow manipulation system. At a certain moment in time, which is how we define this idea of an event, is that moment in time, we're going to want control flow to move to some code that we've specified. So that's an event system. Let's take a look at the problem that this idea solves and how you might work your way toward that solution. So up here in different colors, I'm going to write some code for different files. This first one is the infant file. We've got this little tiny family with an infant and a mom and a dad, and each file, all the code for these three different individuals is in different files, right? So infant is an object, and the infant has the ability to cry. Infants cry so that they get attention. It indicates that they need help in some way, and someone should come to their aid, right? Separately, in this other color, in another file, you have mom. Mom is a pretty simple object, at least in this example. She has a feed method. She's capable of providing food to the child, right? We are not showing the source code to feed here. It's elided out, but is an object that has the ability to do that work. So you might say that when you want, when the infant cries, it wants the mother to feed it, right? That might be the thing that it needs. And the question is, how would you solve that problem in this source code? You would be forced, as it stands, to add a line to the cry function so that when infant.cry is invoked, mom.feed happens in response. Does this seem like a fair solution to our problem? In this sort of like contrived example, are there any questions about the example code or like why I brought us here or anything like that? Does anyone see a big problem with this code? It's subtle, but it's huge. Yes?
How do you call event.cry?
How do you call infant.cry?
Infant.cry, yeah.
So not pictured here, that's a great question. Not pictured here is some invocation to cry that will happen at any moment in the future. Infants cry on some random schedule. Your whole program might incur behavior that would make the infant cry. Perhaps something to do with the DOM API, right? That was a joke, never mind. So it may be the case at any moment in time that someone will invoke infant.cry, and at that moment, you really want it to be the case that the parents will come and pay attention to the infant and solve that problem. So there's a very big issue with how I've written this code.
Mom.js isn't included in infant. It's not required.
So this is a great point. You're on the right track. The idea was mom.js is not included in infant.js. And the code does not show this taking place. We could imagine that was solved elsewhere, but it's not pictured. Let's examine that issue there, because you're right on the heels of this problem. If you look at my code, the dependency goes from infant to mom, which means infant must have knowledge of the mom system. Infant has to basically, by analogy, voice the fact that it is interested in mom feeding. The source code for the infant specifies what should happen whenever it starts crying. This is a very good analogy for code dependency in general, which is to say, you don't necessarily want the source code of one file, like infant, to depend on some more complicated system. And by depend on, I mean it actually had to explicitly talk about mom. It could be the case that infant needs to be written in a way where it has no knowledge of the other files. This is a very common thing in our programs. For example, the browser provides you an entire environment, and the browser has never seen your code. You write code that will run in the browser, so it's not possible for a browser manufacturer to call out to your code directly. That's why you have on-document ready. It's a way for you to tell the code running inside the browser that there's a moment in the future you're interested in, and even though the browser manufacturers had no opportunity to write an explicit call out to the code that you wrote, right? Because you wrote the code, for example, after they did. That's one reason they couldn't reference your code. There are many of you, and they can't reference all of your code. You can't email them asking them to integrate. So there are real-world examples all over the place where it's impractical for one system to explicitly talk about some other system. And what we need to invert the dependency. In the real world, the mom systems of the world know how to assist the baby systems of the world, not vice versa. The baby systems don't explain what they need and say, hey mom, come feed me, I'm crying. That's what needs to happen here. So this hopefully is a pretty clear analogy to things that you do every day, but I'd love to clear it up if there are any questions about the scenario we're in. We've made it through very few slide transitions so far because the premise is so important. It's very important that we understand what problem we're about to solve using an event system before we move on. So I'd love to just dwell on it in case there's any questions. Anybody want to know anything about the problem that we're facing? thumbs on your confidence that you could voice the nature of the problems that we're facing if called upon and asked to explain what we're trying to fix here. Sorry, for those of you who weren't here yesterday, the day before yesterday, thumbs means thumbs up if you very much agree, thumbs down. This would be like, I totally know what's the problem. This would be like, I didn't quite follow slash at all, and this would be somewhere in the middle. So if everybody could put their thumbs up with their self-rated like sense of, okay, that's pretty good, that's pretty good, I will move forward then. Just to extend the scenario we're talking about, let's add dad.js. Dad, not very effective parent. He's capable of singing when needed, if that's useful. So the infant, perhaps just to sort of throw dad a bone, is going to also kind of depend on dad singing. Really, the infant probably needs food. But, you know, dad can sing too, that's fine. So here's the question, and this ties into what your proposal was to this issue. Imagine that these three scripts, infant, mom, and dad, load in the following order. In the browser, load order is kind of haphazard. And you could imagine things being asynchronously loaded in almost any environment, right? So dependencies becoming available is something we maybe don't want to rely on. What if infant loaded, what if mom loaded, which infant depends upon, and then infant loaded, so it's got its mom dependency, but dad.js is just, you know, fishing or whatever, and it doesn't show up for a long time, right? This code would break, because when this file is running, assuming the cry happens in between the loading of mom and dad, a call to the cry event happens, the reference to dad is going to break. That is the exact manifestation of the problem that we need to resolve. So, one solution to this problem involves introducing these lines of code here. Under the mom line, we are going to say infant.onCry and pass in the mom.feed function. So all of a sudden over here in mom.js, we are talking about infant, and we no longer have to talk about mom in the infant file. This is an inversion of the dependencies. A method call, therefore, can be seen as the inverse of an event registration. Are there any questions about my claim or about something similar?
Sorry, can you repeat that?
Yeah, so in this world, we had some breakage, potential breakage, because infant does a method call out to some other system. This is basically saying, at the moment that an infant starts crying, we need to pass control flow off to these other systems. In order to invert the dependency such that we never talk about mom or dad in the infant file, we instead talk about infant in the mom and the dad files, we use an event system to invert the dependency. And mind you, the onCry function has not been fleshed out yet, but we're about to do that. So the statement that I was working my way towards repeating was that this interaction with an event system does the same thing that the method call used to do over here. It passes control flow out to mom.feed whenever this crying happens. So by using an event system, we've done the same thing, but with the dependencies inverted. And for that reason, I would claim that event registration is the inverse of method calling. Perhaps the obverse. I'll have to look up the definitions of those two later. So are there any other questions about what I've said so far, or about the opposed nature of those things, or why I insist on using words like obverse? No? All right. So, all of a sudden, if we're going to use a system like this, we have need for the onCry function, specifically the onCry method, right, of the infant object. So what's that going to look like in the way? Yeah. What are we going to add to our code? Where is it going to go, first off? We are calling infant.onCry here. That implies that we need some more code somewhere. Where's it go?
Goes into mom, which goes into the library?
Yes, but specifically if I'm editing my code, you're absolutely right. But if I am editing this code, right, I'm going into my code and I'm like, well, I added this infant.onCry, but I'm not done editing my code because I wrote the line infant.onCry. So before the code runs, I need to finish making this edit. Where am I gonna need to add more code? Sorry, the fellow there.
I have no idea.
Okay, let's reason through it, right? So these are the new lines. Infant.onCry, mom.feed, and infant.onCry, dad.sync. It seems to imply the existence of a function that I don't see pictured. We're suddenly calling onCry, right? So this code won't quite work yet because onCry doesn't exist. It's supposed to be a method of infant because of this dot. So where do you think I'm going to define the onCry function? That's fair. It's going to go in infant. Because the infant file defines things about infant like methods such as onCry. Does that make sense? So I'd like to take a moment to thank, I apologize that I forgot your name, but I won't say it because people, for some reason, become embarrassed sometimes when I call on them and they don't know the answer. Heads up, pretty much every time I call on somebody, they don't know the answer because it's very difficult to track on a speaker. That's just a difficult thing to do. It's not particularly feasible that you're going to keep up with everything I've said and know exactly what my intention was. It's not like reading a book where you get to look at the sentence over and over again until like you understand what's meant by what I said. So I really appreciate you playing along. It's very important that we use this technique of calling on people to break the illusion that everybody around you gets it better than you. You've just relieved a good 60 to 70% of the audience. They're like, oh, I'm not the only one. So anyway, thank you. Right in front of you there, in the blue, what do you think I'm going to add to the infant file? What will the code look like that I'm going to add there? So the call to onCry is happening right here. Infant.onCry is being called in order to tell the infant that when it cries, it needs to call out to mom.feed. Control flow must pass from infant to mom at the event of a crying. But because we're calling onCry, it suddenly becomes clear that we need more code that governs how the onCry function works. That's what we're adding here. So what do you think that's going to look like?
Something that defines that the infant is not crying anymore?
So I'm going to add two things. First, I'm going to define... let's get back to this line of code in a moment. Let's focus on this right here. We're going to need a function, onCry, that we can use to pass callbacks that we want to have happen. Right? So we're definitely going to define an onCry function. Zooming back a bit. Infant.cry, instead of calling out to mom.feed and dad.sing, infant.cry is just going to iterate over a series of reactions that have been registered, and it's going to call them all. It's basically like saying, I don't know who I'm supposed to tell when I'm hungry or fussy or whatever. There's just going to be a set of things that got passed to me, totally anonymized. I don't understand what these functions are. I never had to specify them by name. They just got passed to me. And this loop will iterate across those things and call each one of them. So for each of the reactions to cry, run it. Run that callback. That seems to imply that we're going to have some list of reactions that get registered, right? So we're going to store the reactions somewhere, and that's ostensibly what the onCry function is supposed to do, right? The onCry function takes functions that are supposed to run when crying happens, and it's going to add them to a list. So in comes a callback, it's going to get added to this list so that at the moment of cry, we can iterate across them and do them all, whatever they are. So this was probably the biggest leap in terms of code that we're going to have to make. I just want to make sure that we cover our bases here. Are there any questions about all the code that got added here? I'm having a little trouble hearing you.
What is the significance of the underscore before dot each? I don't understand.
What is this underscore dot each? Underscore is a library that provides certain simple utility functions, and each is one such function. It basically does iteration. Underscore, this symbol, this underscore symbol, is actually a variable name. Underscore is a valid character to use in variable names, and the library, underscore.js, has chosen to use just one character for its variable name and to use a rather crazy character because they think it's a simple place to put default system-like behavior. In effect, this is a for loop.
I don't know if I'm jumping around or not, but when you pass in the function dad.sing or mom.feed, can you pass in a parameter with that?
When you pass mom.feed to onCry,
yes.
Can you pass a parameter?
Because you're passing the function call. Can you? So if dad.sing, if you want to specify a song, could you pass in dad.sing and then a string?
So the question goes, is it conceivable that as a second and third argument to the onCry function, we could pass along the arguments that we want dad.sing to receive at a crying event? That is conceivable, but our code doesn't do it, only because we're gradually building the code from simple to complex. Eventually, we would like to add that feature.
Actually, I meant, so if sing, which is a function, took a named argument, could you specify that named argument when you're calling this dad.sing?
If sing
is a function that takes no arguments. What if instead it took a string? So sing colon function prim song name.
Sure.
So when you pass in dad.sing, how would you specify that param?
I think you're saying the same thing I answered, unless I've missed something. Which I don't mind repeating the answer, but I just want to make sure that I understand your question.
So what I heard you say is I was asking about passing a second param to onCry.
My implication there, although I didn't state it, my implication was that those second and third parameters would be stored so that they could get passed along to sync later.
Okay.
That's totally a feature we may want, but we're not going to consume the feature yet because it takes work to implement the feature. So we're going to do the simple case where sing and feed don't need any arguments.
So I guess, so if I was hearing the answer right, then there is no way to pass a parameter to dad.sing in this particular case unless you wanted to pass it to be pushed in later.
There are techniques that could let you do that, but they would require more code to illustrate, and so I would not go into the details of how to achieve that until after we've made a few more progressions. But but it's absolutely a reasonable goal.
Where is the infant.kind called?
So not pictured here is the moment in the future when someone will inspire the infant to cry. Remember, infants may cry at any moment. Your program has to be poised and ready for the crying to start, right? Not pictured here is the call to infant.cry. It may happen very frequently in your program. It may happen any point after this .cry function is defined, starting here. Maybe it happens before mom.js loads, maybe it happens after mom.js loads, but before dad.js, or maybe it happens after all of the files have loaded. Maybe there's a set timeout. Set timeout, paren, infant.cry, comma, 1 year. That means in 1 year from now, asynchronously, the infant will start crying and everything better happen. Everything better kick into gear. Does that answer your question? Okay.
I'm trying to understand the purpose of the reactions to cry array. What's that for?
I love how you just bamf across the room. I'm just never, it's just all of a sudden.
I didn't need it to start with.
That's totally reasonable. It's just, I was like, she looks so much like, ah! Like Nightcrawler. Sorry, what was the question?
What is
reactions to cry for? Reactions to cry is an internally useful, by which I mean that only infant really cares about this array. Infant is going to keep track of all the things that it's supposed to notify when it's crying. It's a generic place for storing all of the callbacks that should receive control flow when crying starts. So instead of, just going back a moment, instead of specifying mom.feed and dad.sing, these are listed out in the source code, right here. In the old version of the code before we introduced an event system, infant.cry specifies mom.feed and dad.sing. The list of things that need to happen at cry time is typed out in the code right here. But in an event system, we need some place to store all of the things that that will be needed at cry time, all of the calls that need to be made at cry time. Notice we are not any longer listing out mom.feed and dad.sing here. We're just iterating over some list. So the list is where we store all of the things that we used to be naming explicitly in our code. I get the sense that I haven't quite addressed your question.
I'm trying to visualize what's in that array, because I know I don't.
It's an array of functions, one of which is mom.feed, the other of which is dad.sing. It has two functions in it. Great question. So she pointed out that she thought the point of this whole exercise was to prevent the infant from having references to mom or dad. We're not trying to avoid runtime references. We're trying to avoid lexical references. Back here, we explicitly named the mom module inside the infant module. And we specifically talked about the dad module inside the infant module. These are lexical references where I've spoken about some variable that stores, ideally, stores these things, but maybe wouldn't if the load order was screwed up. It's lexical references I'm trying to get away from. What I want is for this file, infant.js, not to include the word mom and not to include the word dad.
So what goes in the array then? Just feed and sing?
So,
you haven't defined it yet. You're not injecting the function into the array.
Yes, I am, right here. On cry. Oh, you're saying
inside
I haven't done this.
Cry.
I don't think that's her problem. I don't think that's what she's taking issue with. So, And heads up, I tend to do a pretty good job watching people think and trying to figure out what it is they're confused about. Many times people will think, I'll help, I know the thing that's missing, but I tend to prefer to do it myself. I appreciate it. I appreciate your help. The difference here is that we would like to avoid naming the mom or dad modules in the infant module, but it's okay for the infant runtime system to have references out to the to parts of the mom and dad system. That's okay. Imagine, for example, the browser. Consider the browser, right? The browser needs to not depend on your code. When the people writing the browser write the browser, they don't want to reference some program you've written, right? Let's say you wrote a program called pizzadelivery.com, right? Pizzadelivery.com has a module called pd.takeorder, right? Or pd. Show alert message. You want to show the alert message as soon as people show up, you got a brand new deal happening. The browser manufacturers, the people writing that code, cannot call pd. Alert. So they never ever want to be forced to type in references to your code. It's in fact completely impractical. But it's okay for the browser code to store references to functions at runtime that you have defined. Does it make sense, the difference between these two types of references, lexical references versus runtime references to functions?
I still don't know what goes in the array.
What does it look like, I guess, is my question.
Yeah.
Maybe you should flush out on the card.
Examples of what goes in the array.
Like, what goes in the, just to be clear, and I would love to do a better job of answering your question, it's just, I'm not sure what I haven't answered yet, so let's work it out. On this line here, it says infant.onCry paren mom.feed. And my claim is that mom.feed, the code that, as you point out, we have not yet written out, onCry should add the feed function itself, a reference to the feed function, into the reactions array. The reactions array should store references to functions like mom.feed and dad.sync. In this code, these two lines of code, infant.onCry mom.feed and infant.onCry dad.sync, that should result in the array storing exactly two values. The first function, mom.cry, mom.feed, and the second function, dad.sync.
References to that.
References to those functions.
That's the key, I think. That in that array,
exactly. At runtime, there will be a reference to some anonymous, like, infant has no idea where this reference is pointing, because at runtime it's possible for one system to talk about another by memory reference, but not have specified it lexically. So, and I think your point about the next lines of code I'm going to add will help illustrate this. So let me do that, and then answer any questions that you guys might have. So what happens in onCry? Quite simply, in order to satisfy this idea that we just ironed out, we need to write code that adds any callbacks to this list. So we're saying this, which refers to infant in this case, dot reactions to cry, the list of things that need to take place when crying happens, push, meaning add, the callback. Add the callback to the list. Now, the problem we have is that we've just had this long conversation about how to implement a very simple idea. The simple idea is control flow needs to pass from over there to over there. And that was really easy to specify in a method calling world. The method calling world just has two lines of code and it's done, and it kind of like makes sense what's going on. In the event registration world, we have a lot more complexity that takes a lot of discussion before it's clear how we're achieving this really very trivial behavior. When crying starts, pass control flow to two other files. So I would call this a design hole in the language of JavaScript and basically in every language I've ever seen. There may be languages out there that facilitate method registration as a first-order primitive concept, But unfortunately, we have to invent method systems in most programming languages. We have to write a bunch of code that you, event systems. We have to write a bunch of code in the method calling style, which is all the JavaScript provides. We used a bunch of methods and arrays and stuff to build the infrastructure necessary for the event system to work. That's a bit of an inconvenience, which is why you are never going to write this code. Other people wrote it for you once. They wrote some event system code. You're going to import an event library, and you're going to play by its rules, and that's pretty much going to be the whole story. You won't need to engage with all of the nuances of how to build your own event system very often. But by doing so today, hopefully you have a very clear understanding of what an event system is and what problems it's solving and how it's solving those problems. Are there any more questions before we continue? Yeah, one more. Yes?
Well, I mean, anytime it goes so far, but what would you do with the React Enterprise array later on after execution? Like, why are we storing them? I said it may be too late, but could you say why we're actually storing them? Like, what's the purpose of holding those functions?
What is the purpose of storing functions, like reaction functions, that are supposed to happen on the cry event? Oh, that's all right. So basically, it's the case that when an infant cries, other systems need to be called into action. And the old example involves specifically naming them in the source code, mom.feed and dad.sing. We want to achieve the same thing, but without naming them in our source code for infant. So storing an array of them allows us at runtime to register that dependency here and achieve the same passing of control flow, but while never mentioning mom in the source code of infant or dad in the source code of infant.
Okay. Yeah, I was just missing how they actually ended up being executed.
Yes, so they get executed. Not pictured here is a call to infant.cry. Perhaps that happens on a set timeout. That would be a good example. Absolutely. So let's take this one step further. Infant is not the only object in the world that will ever need this idea of inverting control flow. In fact, it's a very common pattern. We frequently need, for an arbitrary object in our system, to expose an interface rather like the onCry interface. Can you guys think of examples where that might be necessary? When, with the brown shirt, when would you expect to need an object to be able to expose an interface where it can receive event registration?
When you don't necessarily know what the object is that
you want. Totally, that's the general case. What is a specific example other than infants in your code or in code you've seen before or in hypothetical code where you'll be called upon for a given object to use an event system? And that object may or may not provide an event system natively. When do you ever interact with event systems in your programming? Right, so DOM nodes, perhaps, right? DOM nodes may need to expose an event system. As it happens, they don't natively. DOM nodes don't have a really easy event interface. You can specify what you want to happen on certain events, but it's kind of obtuse. And so someone had to write code like this around DOM nodes. But DOM nodes have at least some support for event systems. Other cases where you're going to register events, maybe if you're using a framework, your model objects need the ability to get event registration on them. You say, when this model changes, I want to do a bunch of work, because that means the data has changed in some way. Anytime this model object updates its age property, I need the UI to reflect that change. And so there's going to be an event, which is the modification of the age property, And that should trigger some arbitrary behavior in your code. There are a lot of examples in day-to-day life when you may want to invert control flow, to invert dependency from one system to another. You don't want to specify system B inside this system A. You want to talk about system A inside system B. And so you're suddenly going to need an event registration system. Anytime you write library code, you're going to need an event, almost any time, you're going to need an event registration system. Because the library code is going to pass some waypoints, but because it's library code, it'll be used by who knows in the future. You're writing library code, so you need to give your users the ability to register what they want done as part of your work, right? So let's generalize the code that we've written so that we can add an event system to any object, anywhere, anytime, no matter what. I don't want to. Here we have a function definition, add event system, that is intended to do all this work. And I'm not done refactoring my code yet, but I do want to call attention to the first step in the process. I wrap up all of my code inside a function, expressly so that later I can call that function on something like infant. And it'll add the whole onCry infrastructure to it. Does that make sense? Any questions about this transition or why I'm doing it?
And you're just passing in, like, what's not there behind the function in parentheses, you pass in the infant object then?
As I evolve the code, I'm going to add a parameter here so that instead of talking about infant explicitly, I can talk about generally whatever gets passed in. But I'm not quite done refactoring all the code. The first step was simply to wrap all my code in a function call, or into a function definition, so that it can be repeated. It's still hyper-specific right now to infants. The next thing I'm going to need to do is specify that some target should be augmented with this eventing system. And at that moment, I'm allowed to replace every reference to infant with a reference to target. So I'm going to switch up every reference that I used to have to infant to be a reference to target, at least inside this function. And now I have a generic event system adder that adds this cryability to any object. What is, yes?
So since it's generic, should it live in infant because it has nothing to do with infant? You see what I'm saying? Like, shouldn't it be in another library or something?
Yes, but I'm only refactoring the code gradually, one step at a time, so we will do that. There's something missing, I haven't quite finished. You there. What do you think I need to do for this code to start working? So let me just remind you of the steps we took, there were three of them to get to this point. First, I took all of my code that augmented infant with this sort of like eventy nature. I wrapped all that inside a function. So instead of running it, I'm defining a generic function that can be run. And since it can be run, I'm sort of saying, well, it can be run on a target, and I define a parameter. And then I replace all references to infant with references to that function input, target. But my code won't work quite yet. I couldn't run this program.
You should generalize all the function names, because the target might not have those functions.
Yes, good point. It may be the case that we want our event systems on other objects to handle things other than cry. But for the code right up here, and we will get to that, but for the code right up here, it actually, if I turned this code on, would not run. Because I haven't called add event system on infant. Right? I realize that's just a trivial nuance. I just want to make sure that I was checked in with everybody. Basically, what I'm concerned about is infant, we're not referencing infant in this code any longer. We need to call this add event system on the infant in order for it to work. And while we're at it, let's just put this whole thing in a separate file, like this fella requested. So here I have the event system mixin.js. And the event system mixin makes it possible for me to add event systems to any object. Now, any object suddenly has an onCry function as soon as I call the add event system on it. Are there any questions about these recent transitions? Ah, so when you write a function, the question was, how does infant become referred to as target? So whenever you write a function definition, imagine the sum function, var sum equals parens ab, a comma b, and then the body says return a plus b, right? You are giving names, a and b, to whatever gets passed in. Similar to a blender has sort of an open hole on the top, and in the abstract, the blender just knows whatever comes in, I'm going to call that fruit. It may be an iPhone. It may be, right, a nickel. Who knows? But I'm just going to refer to it as fruit, and I'm going to blend it into a pulp, right? So you take your nickel, and you say, will it blend? You're calling the object in your hand a nickel. But from the perspective of the blender, it's just coming in the top, so it refers to it as fruit. Similarly, when you define a function, like sum or like this add event system function, you give names to whatever's coming in, and then as you refer to that name, you're referring to the input, regardless of what the input was. Up here, when we call the function, that's like pressing the on button on the blender. We pass in our, well, let's not say blender, this is more like, you know, this is more like sum function, perhaps. In that, as we pass in some argument, infant, it will be given a name, target, for the duration of running the event system at event system function. Does that make sense? Okay. Do feel free to flag a TA down if that poses any challenge as you're working on the exercise. Yes?
Should this be updated to be target?
Should what be updated?
Oh, inside at event system, your references to this.
Right here, the keyword this.
Yeah.
You could replace those with target. That would still work. However, the keyword this is equally good in this case because we have, do you remember the rule? I don't know if you were here yesterday, but do you remember the rule, the primary rule we're going to use to determine what the keyword this should refer to? Oh, that's okay. This is a great opportunity to explore what we saw yesterday and just sort of like bring it into context. The primary rule that we use when we're curious what the keyword this is talking about, the primary rule we use is, does anyone remember? Is the last slide. Just remember this one thing.
Left of the dot.
Left of the dot, yeah. The keyword this will refer to whatever was on the left of the call time dot. So we're looking at the keyword this here in onCry. Where is call time? You with the glasses and the black shirt. Infant. In mom.js, here's call time of onCry. So the first thing we do is we look for call time, and then, oh, I see, you're answering the next question, which is, what is to the left of the dot? Well, here's call time, those are the parens. On the left of the dot is infant, and therefore the keyword this is going to refer to that object. The keyword this becomes useful in this case, but you're totally right that instead of referring to this, we could have referred to target. They conceptually talk about the same things. Cool? Great. Yes?
I just had a question about that. As the writer of this event system mixin, how do you know how the function is going to be invoked? Like, what's the best practice?
Great question. The question was, since I'm writing the event system mixin, add event system, how do I know that onCry will be called in a method-like syntax? How do I know that onCry will have a dot to the left of it at all? Or that it won't be called with dot apply or dot call or something? Or that it won't be passed as a callback to set timeout, in which case it loses its binding? I don't know any of these things. In fact, I think that the keyword this is a bad pattern, and I avoid using it in my own code. I only rely on it when I really need its speed improvements, but I think it is unnecessarily misleading as a language construct, and I avoid using it because I can't guarantee that this is how people will interact with my onCry function. They may copy onCry off of one object onto another without realizing that that's going to change what it operates on. The keyword this does not always quite refer to what you want it to refer to the way function arguments usually do. So I avoid using the keyword this. I would prefer to use the word target. Does that address your question? Most people would use the keyword this because they're going to go, bah, so you know, they'll call it as a method. It'll be whatever the object is dot onCry, surely. And then you get libraries like Backbone that makes extensive use of the underscore dot bind behavior or dot bind all, which is just a terrible hack for getting around the fact that we don't actually call all of our functions as methods, and it breaks everything. And so we do a really unperformant thing, this bind all behavior. If you played with Backbone, perhaps you know what I'm talking about. It's really unfortunate that the keyword this has introduced so much code to patch over exactly the inconsistency or the unreliability of people calling things the way you intended them to call. I enjoyed that question, even if you didn't. All right, so we now have the event system mix in. And the only thing left, I think, is someone over here said, maybe we don't want, it was you. You said maybe we don't want it to just handle crying, right? Maybe the DOM API needs this eventing ability, but no DOM node will ever cry. They're instead going to get clicked or something, right? So we're going to generalize our add event system to handle more events than just crying. And it's a simple few transitions. You could come up with these techniques yourself, but we're just going to zip through them and invent them together in a big hurry. So the first thing I would need to do is change how I talk about the event from being encoded into the method name, onCry. That won't work because it is exactly the method name that we want to be general for all different types of events. So let's, instead of calling this onCry, let's just call it on. Infant.on, and we'll pass the name of the event as the first argument. That way I could say infant.on pretty much anything. This is the intended goal. I'm going to have to refactor this code around this new use case. Does that make sense? Are there any questions about that transition? I just took the word cry out of my method name and started passing it as an input so that method could be used for any event type.
If you use jQuery, does that screw with it? Like, is it on, like, the reserve? I don't know.
Absolutely. So the question is, if we're using jQuery in our program, does that collide in some meaningful way? Does that mean that the .on method, which already is available on jQuery objects, will collide? In fact, it won't, because it'll be a method of jQuery objects, not of the things I'm calling add event system. I could call add event system on a jQuery object, in which case it would cause a problem, but I would never do that. jQuery, I think, actually provides exactly this behavior, so if you have jQuery, you would never go to all the trouble to write this code out because you would be allowed to just let jQuery add event systems to things. But it's a very good corner question. Okay. So now that I've got this new method signature, I've got to refactor this code around it. Let's start by making reactions to general. So reactions to won't be just reactions to cry. It'll be a whole object, reactions to pretty much anything. And then on a case-by-case basis, I'll have an array full of reactions to any given event. Pictured here is an array relating to the cry event. But this object could be used to store reactions to dot cry, reactions to dot gurgle, reactions to dot on click, etc. Or dot click, we could say. Reactions to click. Does this transition make sense? Generalizing the storage mechanism so that instead of only being able to store one array, you can store as many arrays as there are object event types. Thumbs on your confidence that you could explain the significance of this transition in my slideshow to the room if called upon. No problem. That's terrifying. In the purple, could you give it a shot for me? As a thumbs middle person, I feel that you are representative of the type of struggle that everyone in the room is going through to take what I've said in the abstract and make it real and useful to you.
Just look up there at the code. I have a slight problem with the fact that you've got cry hard-coded into the reactions, target our reactions to, but it's being passed in as a variable on the input on.
You're absolutely right, so and that's only because,
confused.
Absolutely. So the concern was, we have cry here, we're passing cry in here, but there's no argument. It's only because we are evolving the code gradually, and we will reach a waypoint where we could run it again, but we're not there yet. So in a moment, we're going to start modifying the code to accommodate even that aspect of this refactor. But right now, I was just trying to make sure that generalizing this line of code, it makes sense why we would make that edit.
I think that makes, without the other line, right, the code is now inconsistent, so it's impossible to explain the relationship between them because they don't work.
Absolutely. It's the case that this code does not work in its current state. What I would hope that we could explain is the relationship between this line of code as it used to be and this line of code as it is now. For example, in a code review, this change might show up as a separate aspect of the delta, and people might make a comment about this line of code changing, and they might say, why did you do this? Even though we could posit that you finished all the rest of the edits, their comment would refer only to this particular aspect of your change, and you would have to defend it with exactly what you might say in response to my question, which is, I changed this because...
You changed it because so that can be a generic object of all any number of custom events that we are going to support.
Exactly. Exactly right. Instead of simply being an array that can only hold reactions to one type of event, we want to instead start talking about an object that can store many such arrays because we want it generalized to many such event types. We need to take the word cry out of our method names to accommodate the fact that we took it out in our use case. We're going to replace the word target.cry, which is the method that gets called on the instance, with target.trigger so that we can trigger any event. And we're going to add this E parameter to both functions. That's this event name right here. On E. Later we would trigger cry on the instance. We need to start talking about the right array. Reactions to bracket, what do you think? Reactions to sub what, right? So reactions to is an object here. Yes, exactly. E is the name of the event, so reactions to bracket E is the array containing reactions to that particular event. And now we are pushing the callback onto the right array of reactions. This code would work with the caveat that we are only making available the cry array. If we wanted to actually talk about any event array, we might want to initialize them as the event specifications come in. So here we're saying, you can kind of ignore this line. It's necessary for your code to work well, but it is not necessary for you to super well understand. You're going to initialize the reactions array for whatever event is in question to being some empty array, if it isn't already there. But I do encourage you to ignore this line as an administrative detail that you don't need to understand in order to conceptually understand the overarching point here. So feel free to ignore this line. In fact, I would encourage you to. Once we have this line, we don't even need one of them specified in advance. We don't need cry to have an array in it because we trust this line to initialize every array that we need for every event type that we register. All right. Believe it or not, that's the end of the slideshow. It has been exactly 1 hour. We have coming up, right after these last round of questions, we have time for you guys to do the exercises. The exercises are stored at, if you're new, navigate to JSConf 2012, 2014. For some reason, I have been saying JSConf 2012 every time I talk about this conference, as if it's going to go back in time. I'm not confused about what year it is. I don't do this with other things. JSConf2014.hackreactor.com will navigate you directly to a GitHub repo. You can download the exercises there and work through them. We have a bunch of TAs who are going to circulate and answer any questions you have. So I would encourage you to use the exercises you find there as a proving ground to make sure that you can actually apply the ideas here and make use of the fact that we flew 6 people out here by asking them questions. By all means, your questions are valid. That's why we brought them, and I hope that we can help you really apply this information. Before we break, I just want to make sure that I've answered all the questions by taking at least 3 of them. Does anybody have a question?
I have a question. Like, how is execution time is happening here? Like, exactly, what's going on? Like, I'm just missing that part. Like, when you call infant.on, what's happening there?
What is happening when we call infant.on?
Yeah.
So infant.on is defined right here, right?
Yeah.
So when we call infant.on, we pass in cry and mom.feed. They get given the names E and CB, and then this work gets done.
Yeah, I understand that. Let's say first we load mom.js, right? And then infant.js.
Sure.
What's happen?
That wouldn't work because mom talks about infant.
Yeah.
One of the files must depend on the other in order for them to interact.
Oh, okay.
It's not possible to build a totally generic event. I mean, I guess conceptually it is if you had generic events and generic event providers, but that's not typically how event systems are written. So in this world, we are only trying to solve the problem where it's okay for mom to talk about infant, but not okay for infant to talk about mom. Okay.
The line that says target.reactions to. What's going on there?
So, in the past, we had reactions to cry. Did this make sense?
Yes.
Now, immediately thereafter, we decided we wanted to generalize our event system so that the method name did not talk about crying per se.
Yep.
Because we want to be able to add event systems to any object, whether that object needs to cry, or click, or shout, or who knows, right?
Yep.
Maybe the infant needs to do more things than just cry, ideally, right? So we generalized our use case here. We generalized, as soon as we started generalizing on to be about any event type, we suddenly needed to be able to store the reactions to various different event types.
Yes.
We need more than just one array.
Yes.
So we make an object that can store any number of arrays, keyed by the event name. That's what this line is doing. Target.reactions2 is an object that can store many arrays like this cry array.
Okay.
Does that?
That one makes sense, and then the next line, it went away, and that's what. So if you go to the next.
When we get rid of it?
Yeah.
What happens? As we are able to get rid of cry because of this line here.
Oh, okay.
So let's back up a second. Cry is the only specified array, and target.on had better be passed the key cry, because it's the only one we can push to.
Right.
We need to fix that So we add a line of administrivia that says reactions to any given event, let's say the one that gets passed in, should be defaulted, this is the default operator, to a brand new array, unless it's already there.
Okay.
So in this way, every time we call dot on, a new array will be initialized.
Okay.
For the new event. And that's why we can get rid of cry, because cry is not interesting or important anymore.
That explained for me exactly. Thank you.
No problem. Yes, in the back.
So you have we changed target.cry or event.cry to show the target.trigger.
Yes.
So that it can handle custom events. But now we're never calling it.
We were never calling it before either. We never called infant.cry in this source code.
Okay.
There was
infant.trigger then, or if the object was infant that you added on the two, would you call then if the object was infant that you added, would you call infant.trigger to trigger whatever?
Yes, not pictured here is the moment in the future when the infant starts to cry because of some code. So in the past, the code that was not pictured was infant.cry paren paren. We imagined that that happened in some set timeout 1 year in the future. Now we imagine that some other thing will happen 1 year in the future. It'll be infant.trigger, quote, cry. Good question.
Infant.trigger
paren, quote, cry, end quote, and paren. Any other questions? Cool. All right, so please download the exercises. We find that while it's extremely enjoyable to watch talks and hear how things are true, it creates this sort of false sense of security where you hear so much truth in a row that it feels very much like you've learned something. But you won't actually reliably have learned it unless you can do it. So I would encourage you to employ the new things, the new concepts you've learned, and run into the sticking points now while we have a fleet of TAs available to you, rather than later when you're like, I thought I understood what you said, but come to think of it, I should have asked, I would not have known at the time I needed to ask this question. Yeah?
So regarding the exercises, I see it goes up to function binding, which seems to be like the end of Wednesday's talk.
Uh-huh.
Where are the today's exercises?
We don't have exercises that specifically cover events.
Uh-huh.
I actually stayed up quite late to make this slideshow for you guys.
So what should we be working on?
Have you finished all of the exercises?
No, I just want to make sure that I'll go back and do the other ones. I just thought there was a specific
set. Oh, no, exactly. Yes, work on whichever parts of the exercises you are most interested in based on all the talks you've been to. Try to complete everything in there. If you reach the end of it, we've got lots of materials. We will dig something up, but ideally, we won't need to build a new exercise since there's so much in there already. Yes?
I wasn't here for the first class, but I'm noticing you guys recorded this.
It's been recorded. We're gonna work to put it online. I don't know how quickly that will happen, but it's my intent to put it online. Any other questions? Yeah.
Can you explain briefly how each method works?
Yes, I will explain how each method works. I'm going to do that in sort of a breakout session over here. If anybody's curious how the each method works, come join me in the front here. Otherwise, TAs, if you could help me by standing up and circulating around, looking for people, asking them whether or not they are able to make the progress that they want to, starting out or continuing the exercise.